Hi, I'm Virginia Spielman. I'm the Executive Director here at Star Institute for SPD in Denver, Colorado.
Hi, I'm Mim Oxenbein. I'm the Director of Education here at the Star Institute for SPD.
And so one of the things that we want to do this month is we want to sort of demystify the topic of sensory integration and processing. I think often people think it's really too complicated, it's too big, it's too mysterious, and so shy away from it perhaps, or leave it to other people to understand. And then sometimes, well, quite frequently we also come across chronically oversimplified versions or explanations rather of sensory processing and integration. So for example, is it just being under responsive or over responsive to sensation and, mm-hmm. and that's the end mm-hmm. of the story? Mm-hmm. Well, it's not the end of the story. And so what we want to do this month is just try and give like little bits of information away to help people get to grips with this topic and feel really comfortable with it. And so today we want to talk about discrimination. And certainly this is a topic that impacts a number of the children and families and adults mm-hmm. that we mm-hmm. see at STAR. And I wonder, how would you explain discrimination and how is it different to some of the other pieces of how sensory processing challenges can present?
That's a really good question, because we actually get that question not just from families and our clients, but also clinicians too. So I think it's important to, you know, recognize that there are things like over-responsivity, under-responsivity, and that's our nervous system's ability to even know something's happened, right? So when you're under-responsive, you don't even know something's occurred. And if you're over-responsive, your nervous system goes into this fight, flight, fright kind of response where it can't even really figure out what the thing is. It's just reacting that it's a danger when maybe it's not. So if those issues aren't happening and you're able to take in sensory information, the next thing that the brain does is it starts to label it, it starts to interpret it, it starts to put preferences on it. So sensory discrimination is really how we define, how we actually label the physical experiences we're having with our external world, as well as even our internal, like hunger or thirst or things like that, and to what degree. Is it a big right. sensation, a smaller sensation, intense, or things like that? So that's kind of how I would define it.
So it's the ability to sort of be a detective mm-hmm. about the sensation that's inside your body or from the external world, and then decide how important it is, what response it requires, where it's happening, what mm-hmm. it means is going mm-hmm. on.
Exactly.
And we're having some discrimination stuff going on right now because next door there's a music group happening, and my brain's having to work hard to say what's relevant for right now yeah. and the sound that perhaps I need to filter out that's going on over there.
See, I'm having the same kind of experience. That is true. Yeah, and I think what's really important to recognize about sensory discrimination is that this is a process that begins in utero. It mm-hmm. begins with the very, very, very young child and babies. It's all about, I think a lot of people recognize, you know, terms like sensory motor play and allowing a child to explore their environment.
Right.
But so much of what's happening is us building our sensory discrimination abilities, like learning about qualities of things, like you were saying, and what that means for us and how we'll react to it and how we use that information. So as well as, you know, I know a lot of people think about like the other great things that come along with babies and that kind of play, like cognitive and emotional things too, but so much of that is the baby learning about their physical world and kind of filing these little things away.
Right, so, creating a database.
Exactly.
And you make me think about how that happens in infancy and early childhood. Yes, it's not just through tactile play, which is often, you know, the sensory play group is all about the one sensory system and just getting messy, but it's also through relationships that we learn
yes.
Mm-hmm. you know, what these pieces mean.
Right. So when you think about relationship, when you think about the young child and their primary caregiver, parent or grandparent or etc., you know, touch, what is caring touch? Mm. What is visually, like the looks on faces that are soothing? What are soothing sounds, right?
Right.
Movements that are calming and stuff. These are things that it requires us to have had this ability to be an investigator. Like you mm-hmm. said, I love that. And kind of like figure out what it means for us.
And maybe something is not quite gonna hurt you yet, but there's high risk, and you learn it because your caregivers right. show you with their sounds and their face and their posture, mm-hmm. and you tune into that. And so again, we see that sensation and emotion and relationship, how intertwined they are.
Oh, yeah, extremely, extremely. And you know, we think about all the different sensations, sensory systems, rather, every sensory system has a discriminative ability, mm-hmm. right? So when we think about things like, you know, you were just talking about vision and tactile and even proprioception, the body's responses, but internally with our interoceptive, mm-hmm. which tells us about our internal environments. Are we hungry? Are we thirsty? Did we, you know, are we comfortable internally? And that helps us to start to label what kind of emotions we're having.
Mm-hmm.
And if we can discriminate what kind of emotions we're having internally with ourselves, that also helps us mm-hmm. in terms of that relational component mm-hmm. to understand better what somebody else is experiencing.
Right, so we start to be able to discriminate the mind of the other person.
Exactly.
So, you know, this ability, this neurological wiring that we have in order to be detectives about our world, it helps us get ready to be social creatures and mm-hmm. academic creatures, and it's such a pivotal foundational stage. And yet, so many children have challenges with this.
So many.
Yeah, and I think something we commonly see is your middle school age child who's mm-hmm. sort of gotten by okay mm-hmm. and then falls apart a little bit as school gets more demanding. Why might discrimination cause stress at school, or what might it look like?
Well, I think if someone's having an issue with discrimination mm-hmm. in particular at any age, one of the things that they're experiencing is a lot of confusion and because they're not getting clear messages, or the messages they're getting don't have clear labels for a lot of reasons. So a person can really start, the confusion can lead to frustration.
Right.
It could lead to, especially when, you know, with your example of middle schoolers, embarrassment
mm-hmm.
Or the fear of embarrassment.
Mm-hmm.
And generally it can be, you know, fatiguing if you have to work that much harder to understand
right.
the information coming through. You've got less energy to put towards academics, to put towards social
right.
development, social skills, and relational development. And so we can see somebody who might be more emotionally reactive,
mm-hmm.
who might be more anxious,
mm-hmm.
More easily frustrated.
So, I mean, I'm hearing that a child with discrimination issues might look like a child with bad behavior,
mm-hmm.
but the root of it might be the sensory piece. They might
right.
look like the explosive child or the oppositional child
mm-hmm.
as they try to control things, the anxious child
Absolutely.
And the chronically dysregulated child, or the avoider who just stays out of those situations that are
Completely.
Really hard, right?
Yeah, right.
But
I think that's
yeah.
a good, exactly. Yeah, I think so. I think that that's, you know, a very common presentation that
mm-hmm.
that families and clients come to us with when they have discrimination issues.
And so what we really want to encourage then is to understand the multidimensional aspects of sensory processing and integration. And so, you know, as the drumming carries on, I'll just say that, you know, one of the things that we want to move away from, 20, 30 years ago, people were saying, well, this child has sensory challenges, and that was the end of the story. And we really want to encourage, find out more, get more information, get informed. It shouldn't be a secret. There are great resources that you can use. And we have educational resources on our website, but they're only in English.
They are, right now.
Right. So we have this great new initiative that we want to tell you about this month. called Project 2.4 Billion, and we are going to get our free educational resources translated so that we can reach that many more people, the non-English speakers. We've looked at who's interested, we've looked at who's asked, we've looked at our website analytics, and we've identified the key languages we want to translate our materials in. And so we want to be giving this information away. And if you're interested in supporting that project, there'll be a link that we'd love you to click on. And we'll be doing this again soon to talk about another aspect of sensory processing and integration. And we do hope that you join us then.